Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this webinar about the future of waterfront heritage zones in post-industrial cities of Europe, or rather, what is the future of the cities and the societies after COVID. This event is a conclusion of the Memory of Water, an artist-led Creative Europe project. From 2017, the six European cities of Govan, Gdańsk, Levadia, Limerick, Ostend, and Stockholm have collaborated on the artist-led exploration of what's next for waterfront industrial heritage in the context of community development. Over 2 years, the participating partners Intercult in Sweden, Stad Ostend in Belgium, the municipality of Levadia in Greece, Baltic Sea Culture Center in Poland, Fable Vision in Scotland, and Ormston House in Ireland collaborated on interconnected activities like city labs, international residences, and film documentary. The main focus of this Creative Europe-funded endeavors has been strengthening the cooperation between artists, culture organizations, and communities in the context of urban planning. As the project now draws to close, this webinar is an opportunity to reflect on the impact of work of this pan-European six cities exploration has had on the artists and partner organizations involved in the delivery. Has the contribution of artists helped to influence policy, strengthen stakeholders' involvement, and amplify community voices? Is there evidence of impact on planning decisions? What were the key challenges, issues, and barriers? To support us in our deliberations, three of the big thinkers around culture in the 21st century will join us today to give a wider view on different aspects connected to the development and regeneration of the cities. This webinar invites you to a conversation about urban planning, regeneration, and community art, a wider view. In this session, Franco Biancini will explore cultural strategies in European port cities, the cultural richness, including in many cases, anti-hierarchical outlooks and traditions of artistic accessibility and inclusiveness, presenting also the case study cities on the edge. Lia Ghilardi will speak about local cultural DNA map mapping, a tactic for co-creating sustainable cities, how the pandemic has amplified the challenges in our daily lives and also given us a chance to reset, rethink, and reimagine more sustainable models of urban development. François Matarazzo will speak about human capabilities and cultural democracy in a very important and very recently developed Rome Charter 2020, a powerful initiative which promotes culture as fourth pillar of development and a core component of local identity. The expert comments will be delivered by Professor Katarzyna Kosmala, University of West Scotland, Agnieszka Wołoczko, curator, artist, and cultural researcher from Gdańsk, and Roman Sebastiański, urban planner and activist from Gdańsk, as well as PhD researcher from University of West Scotland. All three are also members of the team of the Memory of Water. Then the second part of the webinar will open the floor to questions, which we are asking today and also during the course of the project. The Cultural Planners webinar is facilitated by Liz Gardiner, Fable Vision Scotland, and me, I introduce it. I am Ivona Price from Intercult. Now, please see the film, the trailer, which gives some glimpse into what we did during the course of the project. A long documentary of 1.5 hours will be published before Christmas. So please see the film.
Memory of Water is an artist-led project that explores the impact artists can have on making viable post-industrial waterfront and heritage areas.
It's a way to get to know each other, to experience other cultures, other cities, other people, and in this way we are building the Europe in solidarity.
The artists will collaborate with residents, community groups, politicians, engineers and urban planners.
Each city has also nominated very, very interesting artists with different backgrounds, different approaches. I think this collaboration is going to be very exciting for all the cities.
A program of Memory of Water.
My project, the title is The Sun in an Empty Room.
The garden and the river itself.
And yeah, we can start the magic.
An unbelievable privilege, you know,
to work with so many amazing people.
I'm filming the artist's work in progress to each event.
It will be great.
Good morning and good afternoon. Welcome to Govern with Love.
Beware live cables lie on the wet decks. No smoking on board. See your safety precautions and flames from the burners, they blister your neck.
Good morning and welcome to Eye of the River, a webinar hosted by Ormston House, the Limerick partner on this Creative Europe project, Memory of Water.
Hello and welcome to the Memory of Water podcast. Can we start, to start, can you please tell our listeners how you came to be an artist and what kind of work you make?
Water connecting Georgia from Stockholm. So Lise, please take the floor.
Thank you, Ivona. So without further ado, it's my great pleasure to introduce our first guest, who is Franco Bianchini, formerly Director of the Masters in European Cultural Planning at De Montfort University in Leicester. is now one of the associate directors of the Centre for Cultural Value based in the University of Leeds. He's going to lay out the context in which our Memory of Water project has been operating from an urban planning point of view, focused specifically on waterfronts, exploring the myths and reality of what regeneration is doing to these areas, touching on demaritanisation and the tendency towards standardisation. Franco Bianchini.
Thanks, Liz. I will try to share the presentation here. Yeah. Okay. Is it there working?
Yes.
Yes.
Great. Okay. Only 10 minutes, so I won't be able to talk about every slide, but I think it's still useful for you to have them, particularly one slide which talks about cultural activism in relation to port cities. The presentation is largely about mythology of port cities, whether these myths are real or not. This is a very, very difficult question. But there's no doubt that there is a myth about cultural richness of port cities, that it's certainly founded in reality in many cases. The fact that port cities also are not only culturally rich, but they have a tradition of accessibility, cultural accessibility. If we think of Liverpool, for instance, a whole series of poets and playwrights from Liverpool that have been more accessible than perhaps other mainstream poets and playwrights. There is also a remarkable track record of port cities in the old debate on cultural-led regeneration. There's absolutely no doubt, actually even beyond Europe. If we think that the idea of cultural-led regeneration in the modern sense was invented in places like Baltimore in the US in the 1970s, early 1980s. And even in the, for good or ill, there are examples of more modern forms of cultural-led regeneration in places like Dubai that are leading the world, not to mention Bilbao with the investment in the Guggenheim Museum in 1997 that largely transformed the image of that city and made it a cultural tourism destination. Also, clearly a key role in the European capital of culture and European city of culture, as it used to be called. Glasgow was the first city, undoubtedly, to link the European city of culture with urban regeneration with the 1990 Glasgow project. Rijeka, one of the two European capitals of culture this year, together with Galway in Ireland, is also very interesting, doing a project which is more political, exploring different seasons of power, how they've affected and shaped this port city, and in the process, being in conflict, or at least initially in conflict, with the more nationalist, right-wing nationalist Croat government. So there is often this conflict, political conflict between port cities and the national governments. You find the same, for instance, in the city of Izmir in Turkey, which is in conflict with the Erdogan government in that country. But I wanted to mention a case study, which is Cities on the Edge, in which I was centrally involved. It was basically a partnership between Gdansk, indeed, Bremen, Istanbul, Liverpool, Marseille, and Naples, exploring the different meanings of edge, the fact that often port cities are a little bit out on a limb, they are in a peripheral location, so edge in that sense, in a geographical sense, but they're also often politically marginalized. They have a lot of socioeconomic deprivation, but they also have an artistic edge very often. So they have a leading edge tradition of artistic production in different fields. We worked in Cities on the Edge on the assumption that the values of port cities, including being places that were actually experimental, also multicultural and largely cosmopolitan due to the influence of the port. Also places of refuge. Traditionally, port cities are places that welcome refugees. For example, Marseille, that was European Capital of Culture in 2013, has many refugees, as many people from Lebanon, also Spain, Italy, that migrated to Marseille, for example, during the time of fascism in Spain and in Italy, and also other political refugees from African countries, including Algeria. And that has constitutes the identity of the city. Going to see again other characteristics of port cities that we explored, starting point for the Cities on the Edge project is also the assumption that there are city states often have got more in common with other port cities very far away than with the hinterland. They are rebellious. There is a tradition of rebelliousness. The famous image of Marseille with the cannons in the port, on the edge of the port, being turned towards the city to control the city rather than towards the sea. They have autonomous cultural traditions. They are cities also with a very strong informal economy and certainly a love-hate relationship with the media, political, and cultural establishment, economic establishment in their respective countries. What do I mean by that is that, for example, in relation to Liverpool, everybody I think recognizes that it is an essential part of British identity, but there is also kind of embarrassment about Liverpool, often described as a failing city until recently, or a city portrayed, in popular culture as a city of thieves, or indeed Naples, for example, again, essential part of Italian identity, having invented symbols of what it means to be Italian across the world, like pizza or spaghetti with tomato sauce and so on. But at the same time, again, regarded as an ungovernable, unmanageable city with a stereotype that, of course, is only partly true. So that love-hate relationship we find in many, many cases of different European port cities. And Cities on the Edge included different projects, like a project of the rebel lectures. Here it's me, much younger, 12 years younger, interviewing Roberto Saviano, who is a writer from Naples. Saviano had just written a book called Gomorra, which then became a film. And he was the keynote speaker at a conference on criminality. The criminal economies of port cities and what are the possible responses. We also had a project on literature called Rebirth, very clever name, with Alexis Sale, a comedian from Liverpool, in contributing a story, Adam Kaminski from Poland, for example, and many other writers included. We had a film exploring this almost insane passion for football that particularly deprived port cities have. Football as almost like an investment in the miraculous, as something that can give these cities a win in a situation in which often they are actually regularly defeated. Just think of the cult of Maradona, who died just a few weeks ago. In Naples, you find little shrines dedicated to him in the Spanish quarters of the city, and next to San Gennaro, who is the local patron saint. So the project was only partly successful. It was quite controversial and was a little bit boycotted by the press office of Liverpool 2008. But it did raise some interesting questions. For instance, one of the questions it raised was, are these cities really, through their particular characteristics of rebelliousness and autonomous cultural tradition, do they provide alternatives to standardization, the standardization of globalization, or are they simply latecomers to globalization? Interesting question. What has happened in Liverpool since then would suggest the latter, that they are not alternatives to globalization, but they are latecomers. We have seen a significant loss of heritage in Liverpool, a significant level of standardization and cultural demaritimization, very, very long word, believe it or not, there is a whole literature, academic literature, on demaritimization. For instance, the imposition of architectural styles which largely standardize waterfronts and weaken their distinctive elements. So can you actually be successful and critical is an interesting question. As Liverpool, by becoming, in inverted commas, successful as a city of cultural tourism, of shopping, of conferences, in the last 10 years, lost some of its criticality, some of its critical edge? Or was that critical edge always a little bit of a myth, perhaps? So, moving to the current situation, I wanted to mention right-wing populism and right-wing nationalism in particular, because not all the port cities I've talked about, but certainly in the case of many port cities, particularly smaller ones and coastal areas, including former seaside towns, we have seen, particularly since the financial crash of 2007-2008, with the onset of austerity policies and therefore an increase in inequality, we have seen a growing popularity of political cultures focusing on anti-immigration, on being against immigration, and focusing on what I call in this slide the three F's and the three N's. So faith, flag, and family, the three F's, the three N's, nativism, nationalism, and nostalgia. Three N's that are very much behind the message that was leading to the successful campaign by the Leave movement that led to their victory in the Brexit referendum in June 2016. So those political developments of the last 10, 12 years, 15 years, seem to suggest that perhaps some of the assumptions about the progressive nature of many port cities across Europe that informed Cities on the Edge perhaps were mistaken. So one of the questions today is, how does one reestablish a dialogue? How do community artists who are generally interested in a more progressive form of politics establish a dialogue with people who disagree with them, who might be seduced or might actively believe in this populist nationalist right-wing ideologies? Obviously, partly it is a question of fake news, it is a question of manipulation. The popularity of the QAnon movement in the US and similar movements also in Europe is worrying, and there have been interesting projects, which I cannot go into, of artists, for example, in Barcelona, trying to fight rumors and prejudice and fake news. Moving on to the next slide, I wanted to mention the experience of Hull, which is a typical port city that has actually gone through this political culture change that I mentioned. In Hull, the vote for the leave in the Brexit referendum in June 2016 was 67%. Very, very high level of vote also for the Brexit party in the 2019 general election, and a considerable erosion of the vote for the Labour Party. Traditionally, a Labour city still elects three Labour MPs out of three. Nevertheless, we have to ask some questions. For instance, Martin Green, the chief executive and artistic director of Hull, UK City of Culture 2017, has been on record saying that if Hull, UK City of Culture 2017, a big festival, a bit similar to a European Capital of Culture, had happened before the Brexit referendum, Hull would have voted Remain. This is a very big claim, which is actually criticized by political scientists, including one of my former PhD students at Hull University. So we have to ask this question: does cultural participation in a mass event like that change political values? I am skeptical about this, but there is some evidence that it does stimulate, at least in the short term, optimism and hope, reduces loneliness, particularly for older people, very important. And it encourages people to study, to engage with complex ideas. But these positive effects may be short-lived in the absence of a strategy that tries to lock in some of the gains. And that strategy has been largely absent in the case of Hull. So moving to the last slide, the final one.
Yes.
Therefore, the challenge, the political challenge today, also in the context of the pandemic for port cities and indeed almost for any other city in Europe, is whether the political scenarios after the pandemic will evolve towards an authoritarian turn, which will be, of course, very highly contested. There are progressive grassroots movements in society, like the Black Lives Matter movement, like LGBTQ plus movements, that are contesting this authoritarian turn. But where will port cities go? Will there be a difference between the larger ones, like Liverpool, that perhaps seem to be oriented in a more progressive direction, and the smaller ones? Or will there be the emergence of a post-pandemic settlement focused on ideas of resilience, on ideas including a citizen's basic income, perhaps a reduction of the working week to 4 days, a reinvention of the welfare state with a much greater focus on equality, and or indeed could that be combined with the idea of a more 15-minute city, an idea where neighborhoods become much more important, and therefore also neighborhood governance, neighborhood cultural action, neighborhood cultural policies become much more important? These are all open questions. Of course, it is impossible to know how it's going to go, but they are just there to encourage a discussion. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Franco. Huge questions for us to ponder there. I'm now going to invite comment on Franco's intervention from Professor Katarzyna Kosmala, who is chair in culture, media, and visual arts at the University of the West of Scotland. Katarzyna is a curator and art writer who researches heritage and identity, cultural labour, and the discourses of creativity and community in the context of a globalising network society. Key interests are heritage and participation, art production and enterprise, and artist-run projects, as well as gender and the politics of representation. Professor Kosmala has been a driving force behind the development of Memory of Water and is our shadow expert on the project. Katarzyna, you have 3 minutes. Thank you.
Thanks, Liz. Okay, I will try to condense the very broad kind of topic Franco tried to cover in 10 minutes, commenting in three, but let's try. First of all, I would like to mention, referring to first part of Franco's presentation about his assessment in relation to cultural richness of port cities. I cannot disagree with that at all. And in fact, what is really important to mention, always the cultural richness go in pair with the traditions of cultural sensibilities and inclusivity. And this is really important if we really try to uncover and look at the futures of the port cities. Always this tradition of artistic sensibilities and artist activism is the main topic of the Memory of Water project. There is obviously an indisputable link between the uses of arts in port cities in cultural urban regeneration in more general. But we need to be mindful of how do we define and what are we talking about. So I would like to leave aside the debate on agency and art. So first of all, we could have artist-led processes, we could have artist-based processes, we could have artistic activity co-created with neighborhoods, or neighborhoods-driven art activism. So they're all very different and different sets of power and dynamics operating within each of them. So we need to be obviously mindful about the processes and how the art is involved in cultural regeneration. If we talk about the port cities, obviously we cannot talk about just one example. We need to be mindful of distinctiveness of each context. Franco referred to top-down initiatives such as European City, Capital of Culture, grand type of narratives. I would like to also acknowledge the uses of arts in much more grassroots-driven initiatives in planning, which I would like to call, grassroots level planning, meanwhile planning, or activism-driven planning. So, and a few examples to mention is obviously pioneering work of East London Docklands project led by Dr. Lorraine Leeson from 1980s in London. Or for instance, if we talk about European context, we can refer to Park Fiction in Hamburg, Germany in 1995, which eventually realized in a park in 2005. So, currently, there are also ongoing planning initiatives, which are really important to mention, this grassroots type of cultural planning. And I would like to acknowledge the two examples, which are obviously related to this project, which one is obviously Gdańsk Shipyard, and the other one is Graving Docks in the Govan area of Glasgow. Linking with the reindustrialization ideas, reuse, and also idea of looking how to revamp the very rich heritage narratives of those locations. So in a way, in contrast with the top-down approaches, the bottom-up processes require a proper mediation. Franco mentioned the importance of a dialogue, and indeed, the bottom-up process is to be heard. They need to negotiate its position and its voice despite operating power structures and not to risk ending up in the art wars like many of them inevitably will do. So this proper mediation, this proper middle ground is a very significant element, and perhaps we could pick it up at some point during the webinar in a discussion. And finally, I'd like to come back to Franco's point linking to the Cities on the Edge initiatives he mentioned. And the danger of mythologization and self-mythologization concerning identities or constructing identities of port cities, which perhaps is also in a contrast with the contemporary political outlooks. We are very mindful and very aware of the rising nationalism across Europe. We are obviously mindful about the variation of globalization, which are upon us, and we cannot really argue with that big kind of trajectory which is there within the port cities across not only Europe but globally. But what we need to be also mindful is to look at the artist's role in the myth-making process. On one hand side, yes, myth-making processes can just end there. But on the other hand side, myth-making processes can perhaps contribute in a way to missing elements in cultural strategy in European port cities. First of all, if we talk about the intersectionality of the identity of the place, if we talk about the intersection of the class, and obviously in the context of the port cities, we're talking about the merchant histories and tradition coupled with very much with the working class and migrant identities, which are very rich indeed, kind of cluster of cultural diversity. And in the same time, we have to look at the gender, race, and origins. So all these intersectionalities perhaps need to be looked at in a direction of travel, of creating the voices of what is the port city of the future. And secondly, perhaps the myth-making processes can help us with the idea of hybridization, the kind of the hybrid ideas of how can we look at the globalization and challenge the dominant narrative of nationalism. And perhaps linking with, again, final point which Franco make about the neighborhood governance, perhaps there is a space and possibilities within that dimension to take over and operate. So I would like to finish there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Kosmala. We're definitely pressed for time now, but Franco, do you want to come back quickly on any of Katarzyna's comments?
No, I agree with them. Obviously, Katarzyna mentioned all sorts of things that I didn't mention in my presentation, because you know it's a 10-minute presentation, so I just focused on one particular aspect, which is a political challenge. Of course, I could have given another presentation on culture-led regeneration, differentiating between top-down and grassroots and all of that, but I didn't talk about that. So it was just basically focused on just one particular issue, and which I think is an important one. And but yes, that's it.
Thank you, Franco. I'm going to move on now to my great pleasure to welcome Leah Gallardi, who's a creative polymath and urban sociologist. She's internationally recognized as a leader in the delivery of sustainable culture-based regeneration plans and visitor strategies in contexts ranging from large cities to smaller rural areas. Sweden knows Leah very well from her work in Malmo and other Swedish cities and towns. And Leah's going to speak about the need for cultural mapping. Leah.
Gonna unmute. Thank you very much, Liz. Thank you, Katarzyna and Franco, for introducing what I'm gonna expand on or say. We have a lot in common in what I'm about to say. So I'll go on full screen, if that's okay. Is that working?
Yeah.
Okay, so the question at the beginning of this conversation was really, how could you imagine waterfront cities in the future? How can we imagine a regeneration of these cities? And I think from the point of view of a sociologist, the first question I ask myself is, yes, how can we imagine the cities of the future, especially in a post-pandemic time? But a more important question right now for me, I think, and it's a concern of many, many members of communities in cities, is what kind of a society do we want to be? What kind of cities do we want to live in the future? The future is here. The future is happening now. So I welcome this conversation, and I welcome the possibility of offering some of the reflections I've been preparing and doing over the past 9-10 months. So there are some key aspects, I think, of the society we are leaving behind, maybe, or we come from in 2020. One key one is that the market is governing our lives. There is no getting away from it. To the point that, as we were joking about algorithms picking up our words and then sending us emails, sending us products that we haven't even dreamt of wanting. So everything is for buying and selling. To a certain extent, we are aware of that. But when we come to a pandemic, we kind of realize what we are doing. Why the kind of the market values are now predominating onto human values, and how we need to recover, those values in the future. There was Michael Sandel had a talk, the philosopher Michael Sandel had a talk at the beginning of the lockdown, a lecture, and one of the people in the audience asked, how would the vaccine be delivered? And Sandel just said, by Amazon Prime, pandemic Prime will be the way vaccines will be delivered to certain people. And then we come to the second point of what I wanted to say in terms of the society we're leaving behind, maybe, if we manage to produce some incremental changes in the future. We are dominated by a certain kind of hierarchy of meritocracy. Everybody who can buy a degree is going to do that, because that is going to ensure status and the potential of wealth and well-being in the future. But in this meritocratic society, there is a lot of people that are left behind, a lot of excluded people. We talked about exclusion, and Franco mentioned that too. We know we're living in a divided society, but it seems like there is nothing we can do about it at the moment. But the society we are living in is generating unhappiness. It has actually, it's been shown during the pandemic that the people who are excluded, the people who are, in a sense, those that take care of us, work in hospitals, that clean our houses, etc. It shows that they don't count in a meritocratic society. And they are those that are got ill and died in great numbers. So what kind of a society is this where we have this kind of divided world? Is there anything we can think and do about? We have developed a vaccine in 10 months. Why can we not think of a better society and better cities for the future? So material inequalities are all over the place, and the people who don't have those goods that the status people with money and merit, etc., have, they try to acquire them, and in so doing, they bankrupt themselves. They have mental health problems. So we are really a society that is going towards a crash. If we keep maintaining the same kind of market values are the key values for our livelihood, then it really is a disaster zone also for the planet, as we well know. In cultural terms, because we're talking about regeneration, etc., we have seen, I think everybody can have seen in the past 20 years, the propagation of the idea, which I call the Floridization of cities, which is essentially the idea that the city is a playground, jobs will go to places that provide the right atmosphere, the right environment for the so-called creatives to thrive, and then there'll be a trickle-down, economic trickle-down, etc., and that economic trickle-down will go and feed a second-class workers, a second class of citizens in those cities that will presumably benefit and be happy with paying higher cost of living and so on. So it's been this idea that culture in general could be mobilized for making cities cool and therefore prosperous, I think has been put into question for a long time now. But since 2013, Michael Stolper, an economist, an American economist, really completely demolished this mythology of the city as a playground. He simply said, analyzed city after city, case studies after case studies of city that prospered only because and only when they were made by people who acquired new skills, educational institutions working well for the economy, and cities having visions for the long-term sustainability and resilience of their communities. Also, he said, jobs don't go to places that simply have a nice concert hall or nice informal markets where you can buy your eco products and all the rest of it. It's not just that simple. Cities that really thrive over the long term are the cities that take their communities with them. And they are the cities that historically have had industry in there. And they are the cities that have been able to re-specialize in the skills that they were doing, they were good at doing in the jobs, in the kind of cultural distinctiveness that was mobilized, etc. So that kind of mythology has been really, I think, demystified and deconstructed completely, not only by Stolper, but by many others, including myself in my projects. So we want for the future less of this, and you can imagine gentrification and all the other problems. This is Brixton, where I currently live. And over the past 10 years, really, this has been, there has been a complete change, a complete cultural change. So the young professionals, we call them professionals, or sociologists and economists call them professionals, because they simply have bought their degree in some kind of activity that is the market needs, but really don't contribute much to the community where they live, apart from paying revenue. And those that have shops, like the old crusty that you see here, are considered the losers of the situation. So people look down at the old crusty and they humiliate the old crusty in a way that they say, we don't need you anymore. all we need is this kind of clustering of bars, cafes, cool places where we can go and chat and shout and drink, etc. So that kind of humiliating second-class citizens, in a way, is what feeds populism, guys. So is what led us to Brexit and other things, and Franco very well pointed that out in his presentation. If I think of what Fintan O'Toole wrote, the Irish writer, at the time of Brexit, he says it's exactly this feeling of humiliation that the lower classes, the people who work with their hands, the people who take care of our elderly people, etc., the people who clean their houses, etc. It's exactly that kind of feeling of humiliation of us, the talented middle classes, looking down at them and thinking that they were not really part of our networks, and they, effectively they don't have access to our networks. It's this humiliation that has brought us to populism, etc. So what do we do about that? So shall we start with, we need to start from somewhere. And from my point of view as an urban sociologist, I started looking at cities as a complex system of relations. They are not just a machine to bring in revenue. They are ecosystems. They are systems where everything is connected. The economy is connected with the way we develop place. Planning is connected to the way we envisage human beings living in that society. So the city is actually the ecosystem that should be thinking for us about how do we envisage a good life for everybody. So that's the value with it. And the principles then, what are the principles? So I think the principle that I'm learning now to kind of my reflection is like, if we don't grow the quality of life and well-being of the people who live in a place in the first instance, because we have this notion, but because everything is marketized and all values are dictated by the market, we think if we grow the economy of a place, if we create more jobs, that place will prosper. I'm afraid it's not like that anymore, and it probably has never been. We are not even measuring GDP anymore with the old measures. We are going to have to learn to measure success, GDP, with the measures of well-being. Well-being. How is that community feeling about living there? Have they got the opportunities of achieving their potential? Are we giving them, with our policies, the possibility? Are we giving them the capability of thinking about how they can be in the future, how they can live in that place as human being, as a society? Are we thinking about the common good anymore? Or is that a too old concept for us today? So when we talk about resilience, even from the point of view of really trying to redress the disaster that is that in which the planet is, we need, I think, to be less extractive of value in our thinking about cities and regeneration. We cannot think anymore, we have resources in this particular neighborhood, in this particular city, etc. We can extract the maximum value of it for a certain group of people. We need instead to be more restorative of energy, restorative of resources. So we need to be more active ecologically in that ecosystem that is the city, and think more in terms of providing opportunities for everybody to grow and be resilient, because it's only through that that our economy will grow. If we have a kind of school system or educational system or cultural system that excludes the majority of people, it's that we will never build a fair society. We will never have a spatial justice, even in cities, if we have bad housing for certain people and luxury houses on waterfront developments. So how would I do that? For me, one way of going about doing that, delivering that kind of city where common good dominates instead of the market values. I would use more tactics rather than strategies. We know the Desertot argument that strategies are the tools of the powerful and tactics are the tool of the weak. But he says, tactic is the art of the weak. What it wins, it cannot keep. Now, this is interesting because in war, Desertot argues, like in war, it's always really the guerrilla, those that hide behind the bushes, those that then suddenly emerge from there with sudden strength and disappear again. So it's like tactics are ways for us to reimagine strategies, to feed into the kind of power, to feed the visions for our future. So we go back to the idea, we co-create cities, we co-create regeneration. We start from below. I would say we don't so much start from below, we start from within the city by asking ourselves, what is going on in this city or neighborhood? What kind of action can I take in order to add value to that particular community initiative that is already going on? What are the needs of this community right now? How can I help them? And this is where the government needs to be enablers more than deliverers of services.
Yeah, you have 2 minutes.
They need to be enablers in the way that they enable culture. And in this sense, we have, that's where the cultural argument comes in, not on the Floridization of cities, but in the way that, for example, museums can play a different role in that. They can help our community grow, but not by simply showcasing their existing collections and from a position of power saying, this is who you are. It's the opposite. It's by saying, what kind of memory of this place do you have? How do you feel about living here? So there is a lot of initiatives developing in the last 9 months from museums that says they collect memories, for example, of COVID. What did you do during COVID? What happened? People are collecting memories. They are collecting actually archives. They are making archives out of Black Lives Matter events. And they are inviting activists to come in and co-create those collections. So culture can definitely help reimagining places in a concrete way. It can, as I said, it can help us work out what is already happening. How can we help this community push forward the ideas that they have? How can we bridge the gaps between specializations and languages in a city? We talk to planners through tactics, and we put the result of those tactics to the planners, which at that point will need to enter into a conversation with the community. But I think there is one element here that culture can do is unlocking empathy, which we seem to have lost in society and in communities. By unlocking that empathy, I think we can get at that anger that is pervasive in contemporary society. And maybe we can restart from there, building our cities. Thank you.
Thank you, Leah. Fascinating and a deep discussion there. We're going to ask now for comment from Roman Sebastianski, who's an architect and urban planner. For almost 20 years, he's been active in the regeneration process at the former Gdansk shipyard in Poland. He's the inventor and facilitator of the artist's colony there. He's worked as an activist, coordinating public engagement in the preservation of the shipyard's cultural heritage. Roman's completing his PhD study in the role of arts and activism in participative urban planning at the University of the West of Scotland. And Roman, you have 3 minutes.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Leah. I cannot disagree with your diagnosis of the situation. it's certainly, it is like this. The question is how we can sort of overcome all those problems in the cities. I think that what unites all those diverse problems is a problem with democracy. So when you say inequality, when you say exclusion, when you say lack of access towards the decision-making processes, everything actually comes with the problems of who decides. So when we say, for example, exclusivity, that one group is excluded, but the situation is kind of strange. In the democratic society, the minority excludes majority, we may say. So as this is very challenging. This is very challenging situation, especially in the legal democratic system. So I was actually struggling with that in Gdansk in practice. So the question is why the majority actually has no power to decide and cannot participate in the decision making. And I think that might be many different interesting questions. I think for certain reasons, some of those people, they just don't care. So the question is why they don't care, why they don't want to get engaged. And this is the role of arts, of course. Artists can create situations trying to sort of visualize the situations for those who are, let's say, not interested currently, and engage them in creating the new reimagined situation. And I also believe in your kind of tactics based on desires and reimagination of the places. And I also think, and it actually happened in Gdansk, that we used this tactic and it worked very, 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 very well. The question is, okay, we have the vision. The vision is democratically built. It's our common good. It's actually ours. And then the very important question is how to proceed later on politically, how to make this new democratically built social vision so powerful to engage in the politics and be powerful enough to be listened by the local politicians and to be sort of executed on the highest level as a kind of policy. And this is really difficult because you can have a great imagination, you can even build a group of very much engaged people and create a very, very sensitive kind of a product of how the city could be in the future. But then there is a whole kind of a process of how to get with this message towards the larger society, build the political power and change the situation. Thank you.
Do I have 1 minute?
Yes, we need to move on, Leah, but please come back quickly if you can.
Well, we have the debate later on anyway.
Yes.
Yeah, so we can.
Please respond to Roman quickly.
No, there is so much in there that we need to say. And I think it's a question, first of all, of refocusing our attention on the local, first of all. So within this package of the local, there are all sorts of issues in there. Devolution is one of them in many countries, devolution of power, etc. And then the tools for local democracy, I think there is a lot in there that we can develop and think. Because I think in Poland, you have already at your disposal citizens' assembly as a tool for decision making, which I think we don't have in the UK so much as you have in there. I think it's inbuilt in your local system of thinking. And I think that's where creativity can come in, just starting from there. But again, we need to go back to the local, and whether we are doing a neighborhood plan, which we are doing in the UK, and it seems to be working very well as a tool for rethinking locality, as a tool for rethinking a better life for the people who live in that neighborhood. So there are tools at our disposal within those tactics, but they have to be focused on the local. And that means that maybe we are overrating the kind of democracy, national democracy, which runs by electoral cycles. So maybe we have to rethink that model also, but it's for the discussion later.
Thank you, Leah and Roman. And moving on to our last keynote speaker, and by no means least, François Matarazzo, is a freelance community artist, writer, and researcher. He's worked throughout Europe and in countries as diverse as Colombia, Burkina Faso, and Kyrgyzstan. His writing has been widely translated, and he's held honorary professorships in the UK and Australia. His early publication, Use or Ornament, in 1997, inspired a generation of us working in socially engaged arts practice. Between 2011 and 15, François produced a series of short books on undervalued areas of cultural life under the collective title Regular Marvels. And his latest book, A Restless Art, How Participation Won and Why It Matters, published in 2019, is equally inspirational for us in the field. François was a principal writer of the 2020 Rome Charter, which he and we are delighted to note is already being endorsed by cities around the world. And he's going to talk today on the ideas that underpin that text from the Charter of Rome. François.
Thank you, Liz. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights of 1948 was a remarkable document in many ways and has laid the foundations for the world that we now live in. One of its particular innovations was that in Article 27, it included a guarantee of the right to participate in the cultural life of the community. That idea has been the foundation of all my work and the writing that Liz has just mentioned. But what does it mean? What does it mean to participate in the cultural life of the community? This spring, during the lockdown, I was working with the Municipality of Rome and UCLG, which is an organization called United Cities and Local Government, which is a network of nearly a quarter of a million local authorities across the world. And we worked on a document which has been titled the 2020 Rome Charter. And it addresses that question. Before I explain how and why, I'd just like to show a brief video. It's only just over a minute. Hamish, if you could run the video now, please.
What is culture for? Have you ever thought about that? It's everything we do beyond mere survival. It gives meaning to our perceptions. It brings humanity together through emotions, imagination, thoughts. A group of over 40 cities started an online initiative to advance the right to take part in cultural life as an essential condition for a better society. We're launching a global proposal to promote everyone's right to discover, enjoy, create, share, protect, and participate in culture. It lies at the root of all our connections and in our common future on this planet. Sharing a rich cultural life together empowers us to face challenges and crises, and is vital for the rebirth of our cities and communities.
Thank you. So in order to answer that question, the starting point was Rome as a city wanted to clarify what its commitment to local people was in terms of its cultural rights. And I took inspiration from the work of Amartya Sen and Martha Nussbaum on what's now come to be known as the capabilities approach. So the 2020 Rome Charter is built around five cultural capabilities. By that, I mean things that we all have a right to be able to do. We should be able to do all of these things, and they are necessary in order to exercise our right to participate in the cultural life of the community. The five capabilities are these, that you heard them in the film. They are the capability to discover who we are, our own cultural roots, our identity, our heritage, but also the identity, heritage of others, including the place where we grow up, which may not be the same as our own. The capability to create our own cultural expressions so that we can use culture's power to make meaning and to communicate understandings and knowledge to enrich the life of the city. And then to share, because unless we can share our cultures, our creativity in the social and democratic space of the city, we are marginalized and excluded. We are, in Leah Gilardi's terms, among the humiliated who cannot be heard. And we need to be able to enjoy our own creativity and the creativity of others, the city's collective cultural resources and spaces, for inspiration, for education, for refreshment, for any other of the reasons and benefits that we may derive ourselves from enjoyment of culture. And finally, we need to be able to protect our culture, not only in the sense of heritage, but culture remains contested. It will always be contested because it is fundamentally an expression of values, an attempt to create meaning on the world. And that will always be contested and controversial. It's why we have democracy, to balance those differences. Those capabilities in the Rome Charter are the argument of the Rome Charter is that, as it says, as you can see on the page there, a city working towards cultural democracy fulfills its duty to support its inhabitants to do these things. These are capabilities that all of us should grow up to build and to acquire. What we do with them is entirely up to us. It's of no concern to any government or cultural institution. They are our freedoms, our cultural freedoms, but unless we have those capabilities, we cannot participate in the cultural life of the community. And that is in effect the promise that Rome now makes to its inhabitants, a promise that through UCLG and following a hybrid global conference at the beginning of October is being taken up by other cities and intergovernmental agencies around the world. But a promise needs to be understandable if it's to have any value. So the Rome Charter is deliberately short and direct in its languages and concepts. It was my ambition from the very beginning that it would fit on one side of A4, and that anybody living in the city who was interested enough to talk about it would be able to understand the promise that it was making. That's fundamental, because if we can't understand the basis of policy, then cultural democracy cannot exist. So the Charter tries to enable people to participate not only in cultural life, but also in its invisible and powerful corollary, cultural policy, planning, and spending. The core of it, which defines our right to participate in the cultural life of the community, is the capability to discover, enjoy, create, share, and protect our culture. And we only can respond to the democratic challenges that Roman was just evoking if we are able to talk about what we want in culture and what cultural policy means to us, what the decisions that are made by our big institutions and our local institutions. And that's the purpose of the Rome Charter. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Francois. Wow. I'm going to ask for comment on what we've just heard. Agnieszka Wolodzko from Gdańsk in Poland. She's a socially engaged artist, curator, and cultural researcher who produces art in public spaces and interventions and actions. She also writes blogs and publishes texts on contemporary art and culture. She's a member of the international think tank Transbaltic, the president of the foundation Cultures Beyond Culture. She manages Rhizome, the Center for Research and Participatory Art and Participatory Design. And Aga, you have 3 minutes.
Thank you. Yes, it was very interesting for me to read the text about the Rome Charter, and I would like to reflect it in from a perspective of what we were doing in the framework of Memory of Water, especially in Gdańsk, because I think. The case of the Gdańsk shipyard, that was the place we were working in during the project, is a very good example to look at the recommendations that were stated within the Rome Charter, because the shipyard is now under development and very soon it is planned to become the future center of the city, so-called young city. And it's very interesting to observe how this process is going on, you know, and what is going on there. At the beginning, they were putting down the industrial buildings and so on. It was very awful what was going on there. Happily, this process was stopped. And now they built some new houses, new buildings, and they change functions of the others. For me, the biggest question is what kind of social changes are going on there and to which direction it's going on, and in what sense there will be culture life in this area. There is a very big cultural institution, of course, this European Solidarity Center with a very fantastic archive about the movement, the workers' movement there and so on. Yes, I should mention that this area of the shipyard was played always a constitutive role for our group identity in Gdańsk, because it was the biggest, the shipyard was the biggest employer here in the city. So it is really, you know, these cranes and so on, they are really play such a great role in our imagination and so on. And coming back to European Solidarity Center, it is now, for me, it is a problem that looking at this cultural institution and other buildings that are redeveloped right now, is that step by step, this future center of the city will not be for workers. It was a special place for workers, for working classes who worked there. It was their place, you know. And now we have European Solidarity Center. It is fantastic, of course, as the archive, but it is something about workers and not with workers. And it is, you know, big argument here locally. And the other buildings that are being redeveloped right now, just recently we had two architectural competitions and we could see the proposals of winners. It's the former fire station and the U-boat plant. And you can see what on visualizations, what is planned to be there, et cetera. It looks fantastic. It looks very cool. But it is a question, also a question raised by Leah. Cool for whom, you know? Because it's clear that it is for everything what is planned there, offices, you know, working places, and these cool places for entertainment. Everything is meant for affluent middle classes, you know? There is no place for workers. Even if you look at the style of this architecture that is being planned, you can see that it is for the middle class, for educated people. So I cannot imagine how in this aesthetic context and cultural context, workers could again find a place for themselves to be present, because it was not only industrial place. You must be aware that it was also, in a way, also a place for culture of workers. They had amateur club of painters. There were concerts. Workers were planting, you know, making small gardens there. Workers were also organizing a guerrilla radio that Ivona Zions was presenting in Gdańsk during the. So, and it was very specific and it was on the level, you know, it was engaging non-professionals, engaging shipyard workers. And now it is a question how to, you know, how to include them, because nobody's planning this. So it's very interesting. And I'm asking myself how we could also use the recommendations of the Rome Charter to decision makers in Gdańsk, you know, to somehow make them also aware of these recommendations.
Thanks, Aga. Let's let François come back on that. François, does the cultural rights extend to the rights to shape our places and spaces?
The way in which the Rome Charter is conceived is that if we can persuade municipalities, cities or smaller municipalities, or indeed cultural institutions to adopt the Rome Charter, which is happening already. The only total refusal so far has been Moscow, which I think says something about what the implications, if you like, that adopting the charter mean. But if we do that, then it then becomes possible for precisely the people that you were talking about, the people who feel marginalized and pushed out of an area, to say to the city council, you have promised that I have the right to protect my culture, to discover my culture, to share it, to enjoy it. How are your actions enabling me to do that? Your actions are actually contrary to that. I'm not saying that that resolves the argument, but it provides a basis for a political and democratic discussion about individual rights and group rights.
Thanks, François. We're now able to open to the floor and take questions, any questions from the chat or any questions or further thoughts from our speakers or commentators.
Could I ask a question to François about the Rome Charter? Because it's great that all the cities are adopting it and that Rome City Council have developed it, but knowing the dysfunctionality of Rome City Council in particularly also in cultural services, I have a feeling that they are already breaking the promise. So the very city that has developed the Rome Charter, it's probably one of the worst examples in terms of allowing citizens to maintain this promise. So what is the credibility of this document when, if we don't talk about the actual barriers, the problems that are preventing many cities from implementing these noble objectives that obviously many cities agree with?
The Universal Declaration of Human Rights has been notable for being breached more than being observed since 1948. It doesn't invalidate its importance as a statement of principle and a basis on which precisely the failure to live up to its claims and values can be challenged.
But don't we risk breeding further cynicism if we issue the Rome Charter when even the basics of cultural services are not functioning in Rome?
I think that's a question you have to address to the politicians of Rome.
Can I also comment a little bit, because I think this is very interesting aspect. This is actually what I addressed also to Leah. I agree with you, François, and even in this, let's say, small-scale project in Gdansk, we could use the tons of legal or semi-legal documents about our rights to protect, to discover, to share, whatever. I mean, everything is actually written. I was shocked to discover that if we ask the question about how to protect heritage, for example, we have exactly stated precise answers in many UNESCO and ICOMOS charters, and you know, it also specifying the tactics or the strategies how to actually make them working. The thing is, the arrogance and also ignorance to certain extents of the politicians, and they completely ignore your knowledge, your discoveries, your attitudes. And then the only tool, which is kind of semi even illegal, I would say, is the protest. And actually, in your list, what we enjoyed in Gdańsk very much was the right to protest against arrogance, ignorance of the politicians. And only this kind of violence of protesting, sending petitions, protesting on the streets, writing the protests in the media, that was actually something that worked. That in practice, not all the legal structures that are from 1948, that of course, that's what I say at the beginning, we still live in a democratic countries and democratic cities, but it's to a certain extent meaningful.
I agree. I think one of the difficulties is we have both an idealized and a simplistic idea of what democracy means. I think I've always liked Winston Churchill's phrase about democracy being the worst system of government except for all the others that have been tried. Democracy doesn't work. It's just better than everything else. It's full of flaws. It's full of injustices. It's full of the potential for the abuse of its power by the majority. One of the simplistic aspects of the way in which we conceive democracy is we simply allow it to be the tyranny of the majority, as opposed to, I would prefer that we judged the quality of a democracy by how the rights of minorities are protected, not by how the mandate of majorities are exercised. So I think it's important to say, of course, what the Rome Charter is talking about are cultural rights. And the most important thing about it, as I tried to explain for me, is that it attempts, unlike most of the documents that you you mention, it attempts to be understandable by local people, and consequently to be then the basis of a democratic discussion. It doesn't resolve the democratic discussion, and there may well need to be protest as a result of the failure of the democratic system to meet the demands of not just minorities but silenced majorities and so on. But those are flaws in the democratic system and the way it is open to manipulation and exploitation by the more powerful in our societies. The underlying truth is, and it seems to me to be an unchanging historical truth, that our societies remain unequal. They are always unequal. They are always unjust and flawed. What matters is the degree of inequality and the degree of injustice. And we need those of us who care about justice and equality need intellectual, conceptual, and as well as practical tools with which to argue our case, given that we are the weaker, we are on the weaker side pretty much universally in all of the situations that we find ourselves.
Thank you, and thanks everybody. We're actually over time now. I wanted to give Leah one last word because she wanted to come back on some aspects of the comments.
Yes, thank you. Just 1 minute. I thank Francois for having intervened just now, because I believe the approach Amartya Sen proposed within the capability approach, that is a way of looking in a more sustainable way of generating a better future for cities and communities and people. It's the ecological approach to development. It's not the neoliberal approach to the economy. It proposes a different form of growth for places, but also for human beings. So there is nothing wrong with setting the bar high and saying, within that capability approach, we all have the right to discover who we are, to fulfill our potential, to create something new, to make something of ourselves. I may be an entrepreneur. I don't know. I come from a family of small entrepreneurs. I might have it in me to then generate something else in my life. Why can I not be allowed to do that? So schools, libraries, museums, cultural institutions will need to do that. They will need to play that role of mediators, intermediaries, supporting that kind of approach, I think, which is, in my view, the only one I can see, because it is a democratic one. You give the capability, you open up the possibilities for people to achieve their potential, whether they are, you know, high ranking, low ranking, poor, rich, or work with their hands or not.
Thank you, Leah. Thank you all. I'm going to hand back to Ivona Price now to conclude and tie things up. Thank you all. Ivona, you're muted. Ivona?
Try to mute because I have so many different sounds here. People are coming in. Sounds of the computer. Sorry for that. We just started this conversation. It feels like the same like with our project. We've been working with Memory of Water for 2.5 years, included also the application time, which is more than 3 years, and it feels like we just started. So the conversation is just open. Thank you to all the panelists, commentators, and the audience for your exciting contributions and for giving us your time. The conversation today certainly underpinned not only how valuable culture is for our daily life, of the inhabitants of the cities being a core component of local identity, but above all, how powerful it is for sustainable development. And the conclusion, my conclusion, is that art is also is able to have an impact on the future of our cities after the societies open again. And moreover, it is a vital for rebirth of our cities and communities. But there will be differences in the transition from the era which we are used to, which is research, which is commented very much since years, and which is building on different charts and documents. The era which was mainly probably built for a few, to the dream era of focus on the human beings living in that society, in their neighborhoods, in communities, the not so cool people, enhanced by progressive arts, supported by the cities, enabling citizens to experience the entire process from planning of culture to participation, and measuring the success by the grade of well-being. Those are dreams to fulfill using the power of culture combined with the power of people and the tools available, both charts and the protests. If you are interested in partners' view on the artist's view on the Memory of Water as a project and as a process and as a methodology to work with on waterfronts, please join us during the next session, which starts at 2:00. So thank you again to everybody for being with us today.